I think most people who come to a spiritual path come because they've been searching for something. They were dissatisfied, they were empty, they were yearning for something that was not part of what was already in their existence. For me, it was not that. You know, many people ask me, were you searching for this? If I knew a place like this existed, I would have searched 24 hours a day for it. But in the West, they don't tell you that this alternative is there, that something like this even exists. And I was living a great life. There was nothing in my life that was lacking on any level. I was fulfilled, I had good friends, I had good social relations, I had a wonderful relationship with my parents, I still do. A good education, lots of career opportunities, everything was there. So for me, it was not a matter of there being an emptiness that needed to be fulfilled. I came to India not knowing that I was searching. Obviously, the soul was searching, but I wasn't aware of it. I came to Rishikesh. I stood on the banks of Ganga, and I burst into tears. Before I got here, I didn't even know Ganga. In fact, in the guidebook, all that which had appealed to me was river. I was always a nature person, always an outdoorsy person, and I thought, oh, this will be really nice. It'll be a river, mountains, a picturesque place where we can relax. And I stood on the banks of Ganga, and I had come home. It was as though I was 25, and it was as though 25 years of my life was on the one hand, and then this was on the other. And it had nothing to do with a decision that I made or any intellectual rationalizing or weighing pros and cons or even an attraction. Sometimes people say, you know, what attracted you here? And it was nothing like that. It was home. And it was undeniable. And I spent many, many days just sitting on the banks of Ganga, crying. Not sad tears, but tears of having come home. Tears of finding the truth. A truth that I couldn't articulate, a truth that I couldn't name, but a truth that my soul felt and that my soul knew. And I knew I needed to stay. At that point, I had not yet met Pooja Swamiji. And one of the things that kept, I don't want to say bothering, but nonetheless, that kept going on in my mind during this time was, okay, I'm clearly supposed to be here. Clearly the feeling that I've gotten is so strong and so undeniable that the message is clear. This is where I'm supposed to be. And yet, I kept thinking, if that's the case, if all I'm supposed to do is sit on the banks of Ganga and cry ecstatic tears for the rest of my life, why would God have wasted $100,000 on my education? It didn't make sense to me. Why would God have given me a brain? Why would God have given me initiative? Why would he have put me through the education that I'd been through? He could have sent me here as, you know, a 16-year-old high school dropout and given somebody else the opportunity. And that was going on in my mind, was, okay, yes, here, but where, how, what? I knew that I was not supposed to spend the next 50 or 60 years just, you know, looking at Ganga and crying and being blissful. But the experience didn't hold itself together. I didn't know. And what happened when I met Swamiji was phenomenal because he became the glue that held the rest of the experience together. Suddenly, where and how and why and under whom, it all came together. And he became really the glue that just, that pulled everything together and held it all together. So, it's a very long story. I could take up your whole time with the story, but the essence was what I was offered. Not directly, he tried as much as he possibly could to dissuade me from staying and to send me back. But what I was offered by the universe here was an opportunity to be part of something that was really making a difference. I was getting my PhD in America, and I was already frustrated. I was 25 and I was already disillusioned, and I already felt like, you know, at the end of the day, who has really benefited from my existence? Okay, you got another A on an exam, or another teacher said, oh, you know, very smart comment you made. But that wasn't what I went into it for. I went into it to help children. I was doing pediatric neuropsychology. And yet at the end of the day, children were not benefiting. And I felt like there were all these hoops that they kept saying you had to jump through. First, okay, you graduate high school. Then they say you go to college. And then they say, okay, you graduate from university and you get a good degree and you go to the right university and you get good grades. And I jumped through all those hoops, and it was like every time you jump through another one, there was yet another one that you keep asking, well, when does my life get to actually make a difference? And when do I get to actually help people? And there was always one more hoop held out just a little farther beyond. Oh, just do this. Just you'll get this degree, or just you'll perform this research, or just you'll finish this internship. And here, it was like here and now and today and immediately, you can be part of something that's making tangible, palpable differences in the lives of so many people. And along with that, a life that offered me joy and peace and meaning and connection.
To watch more, log on to www.erosentertainment.com.